Hey, I'm Chris. This is MMA For You. I'm going to be doing my predictions for UFC 194, Aldo versus McGregor, which happens on December 12th. But before I get into that, I'd like to plug my author's website at www.chrismoldon.com. I am an aspiring author specializing in the fantasy genre. You can check out blogs, the Writer's Talk web series, free short stories. I just put up a new one called The Bridge, and buy stories of mine for sale as well. Also, on January 1st, my first novel, which is a fantasy action adventure called The Mustard Prince and the Condiment Kingdom, is coming out on my website. To celebrate that, MMA For You is putting out a predictions contest. Send in your predictions to UFC Fight Night 80, or send in for UFC Fight Night 80, for UFC 194, The Ultimate Fighter 22 Finale, and UFC on Fox 17. You can send in your predictions to the CND channel at gmail.com. If you choose to send your predictions per card, make sure to send them before the respective card. So like UFC Fight Night 80, send your predictions for that card before the card actually happens. Yeah. And with that said, let's just go to this card. UFC 194, supposed to be the biggest card of the year. As far as talent goes, this is one of the biggest cards of the year. The main event, awesome fight, Aldo McGregor. Weidman versus Rockhold could be a pay-per-view headliner. You know, it's the co-main. Yoel Romero versus Jacare could headline a UFC on Fox card. You know, it's the third fight down. Maia versus Nelson. That could headline a Fox card. Same with Holloway versus Stevens. You know, or not a Fox card, an FS1 card. Maia versus Nelson or Holloway versus Stevens can be the main headliners for like FS1 cards or Fight Pass cards. You know. On the prelims, we have Faber, Tecia, Torres, two welterweight prospects in Alves versus Covington, a blue chip prospect in Kevin Lee. On the fight pass prelims, blue chip prospect in Magomed Mustafaev, a fun action fight between McDessie and Medeiros. You know, I mean, the worst fight on the card really is the first fight on the card. It's Marshall Alexander Jr. versus Court McGee. That's not even a terrible, you know, it's like a mid-level card, you know. Court McGee, you know, mid-level fighter, you know. Let's just get started. Okay, in the main event, Jose Scarface Aldo fights notorious Conor McGregor. Conor McGregor, 18-2 record, 16 wins by KO or TKO, 1 win by sub. He also has 2 losses by submission. 27 years old, he's going to be 1 inch taller, but 5'8". He's on a 14-fight win streak, training out of SBG Ireland. He is a UFC interim featherweight champion and big for 145. I mean, he's talked about going up to 155, and when you see him too, I mean, he looks huge. He looks really big for the weight class. He's a strong boxer. He uses combinations and a money left hand. I mean, he's put away some good to great fighters with that left hand. He has good kicks. He uses them mainly they're kind of flashy though. Like he'll do the spinning wheel kick and whatnot. The main thing about his style is that he is a pressure fighter. He is always going forward, and he's got a strong chin. His takedown defense is a bit questionable just because the only guys he's been able to take him down somewhat consistently is like Chad Mendez. And when he was on his back against Mendez, he looked pretty bad too. But I don't know if that's like the best we've seen from McGregor, if he even practiced like wrestling at all or anything. Jose Aldo, 25-1 record, 14 wins by KO or TKO, 2 wins by sub, 29 years old, he's 5'7". He's on an 18-fight win streak, training out of Nobu Nya. He is the UFC featherweight champion He's known for his Muay Thai, but more in particular, his leg kicks. Those things are devastating. He has some strong knees, heavy hands, a really good uppercut. For example, good overhand as well. Real heavy-handed. His overall defense is good. The only time I've ever seen him in trouble in the stand-up was against in the second fight against Chad Mendez. His takedown defense is really good. His ability to get back to his feet is really good. And he is a legit Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belt. This is an interesting fight. There's some things about Conor McGregor that worry me. And it's the fighter that he's kind of become. You know, he used to be, when he started the UFC and he beat up like Brimage, you know, he's like slipping punches, throwing combinations and whatnot. A little more just defensively sound. You can see it even going so far as like the Brando fight, the Seaver fight was kind of obvious there too. And especially in the Mendes fight, I think McGregor, he's become something of a pure pressure fighter. And who's relying on his chin. I haven't seen that defense that he used to have. And I think it's kind of problematic because even in the Mendes fight, even in like the Seaver fight, he takes hits. He just kind of takes hits now. You know, it's like he doesn't seem, it seems like, it's almost like an ego thing almost. It just seems like he knows he can put guys away and he knows guys generally can't hurt him because he's got a really good chin and he's become a representative of that type of fighter. So he just pushes forward, tries to put his opponent away and will take hits in the process because he knows he can put him away, you know, and they can't put him away. I find that a bit problematic. Jose Aldo, I don't think he has that problem, you know. I would argue that he's the more diverse fighter. He has a leg kick. Like, even with the leg kicks, you know, I remember, like, Conor McGregor, he fought, like, Poirier, right? He just, like, Poirier was throwing a couple of leg kicks, and McGregor would just kind of, like, taunt him and just keep going forward, you know? And it's kind of like, and then it didn't even seem like he wanted to even bother defending the leg kick, you know? I don't know if we're going to see a change in McGregor and be like, oh, wow, he's more defensively sound, you know, in this fight. But, you know, from what I've seen so far, it just kind of seems like he went from he changed as a fighter. And it's a fighter that can win, but for a very short period of time. Eventually, chins don't get better, they only get worse. And if you're just taking strikes, you know, just because you know you can, like, give them out, then, like, you know, it's not conducive to, like, the longest career. I'm going to have to go with what I've seen recently, though. You know, this is just kind of the fighter he has shown himself to be at this point in time. And Jose Aldo, the other thing about Aldo too is if he gets trouble with the stand-up, he can always take the fight to the ground. He did that against Korean Zombie. He's taken down Hominick. He actually has a pretty decent double leg takedown, you know? And so with that said, I got to go with Jose Aldo to win this one. I mean, I'm not saying that McGregor can't win, okay? He can definitely win this fight, okay? The guy hits super hard. That left hand is money. And despite what I'm saying, it's not like what he's doing is very unskilled, you know? But like I said, I do feel that he is forsaking defense for all. There we go. It seems like he's forsaking defense for offense. So that'll get him knockout wins. And yes, he's going to be able to do that against Aldo. But Aldo should also be able to hit McGregor as well. So with that said, McGregor's tough. He's got that really good chin. I'm going to go Jose Aldo by decision. Maybe he gets a KO or TKO. Knowing Aldo these days, though, also, and also how he's always in cruise control when he's ahead, which could be, which also is a bit, you know, like scary for me, too, to pick Aldo because he goes to cruise control and will lose rounds because he knows he's ahead. So that's something to worry about with Aldo. With that said, though, Jose Aldo by decision. Next fight after that for the UFC middleweight title, we have the All-American Chris Weidman versus Luke Rockhold. Luke Rockhold, 14-2 record, 3 wins by KO or TKO, 9 wins by sub. That says 2 losses by KO or TKO. Despite that, one was the Vitor on TRT. The other one was like early in his career. So, I mean, he's got a good chin. He's 31 years old. He's going to be 1 inch taller at 6'3". He's on a 4-fight win streak, training out of AKA, and he's a former Strikeforce middleweight champion. He is big for 185. He's a strong kickboxer, particularly strong kicks. If I'm not mistaken, he's a southpaw. He has a really good, it's like a check right hook, or like, I don't know if it's necessarily a check right hook. Might be. But it is like a step back right hook. Strong Brazilian jiu-jitsu skills and really strong takedown defense as well. Chris Weidman, 13-0 undefeated record, 6 wins by KO or TKO, 3 wins by sub. He's 31 years old. He's 1 inch shorter at 6'2", training out of Cerro Longo. He is a UFC middleweight champion and he is big for 185 himself. However, recent reports have shown that he is already down to 192 pounds. So that speaks well for his nutrition, potential cardio, and just his overall discipline and training. So, you know, it's always a good sign to know, like, a fighter isn't, like, terribly overweight and cutting, like, 15 pounds or something before the fight, you know, something like that. So, with Weidman, strong wrestler, you know, just has all those accolades, strong Brazilian jiu-jitsu skills. I mean, this is a guy that if he didn't do MMA, could do professional BJJ and probably be one of the top Brazilian jiu-jitsu practitioners in the world. Wants his matchup against Andre Galvao, for example. He is a pressure fighter, too. He's always pushing forward, and he has strong boxing and uses combinations. This fight is so hard to call. I'm just going to say it right now. Both of them stylistically aren't that similar, but they both have styles that almost nullify each other. Rockhold, he's a good kickboxer. He's a particularly good kicker, you know. He can keep his opponents at range with his kicks. I mean, his hands aren't too bad, but I think Weidman at this point has the better hands. And his takedown defense is really good. I see Weidman having a really hard time with his takedown, taking down Rockhold if he chooses to. Now with Weidman, he is a pressure fighter. He's always moving forward. You know, he boxes well. He boxes in combination, which I really like. And likes to get his opponent like as close to the cage as possible. So I kind of wonder if Weidman can close the distance on Rockhold, you know, just with the style that he employs, or if Rockhold can keep distance, can keep more open space. The other thing is, with Rockhold being southpaw, if he chooses to use the rear leg kick, especially to the body, I think Weidman does show some susceptibility to body strikes. So I'm kind of wondering if Rockhold will utilize the rear leg kick to the body that can actually really, that could actually aim for the rib, or not ribs, the liver. And that can potentially finish or at least greatly damage Weidman. So, but like I said, I don't know if Weidman's going to give him that opportunity by pressuring him. I can also see him clinching him against the cage a lot, too. So with that said, I think this one's so hard for me to call. Like, honestly, like the more I think about this fight, the more I'm like starting to like think of like, oh, this guy can use this tool. This guy can have that tool. This guy can counter that with this tool. You know, they have this like I said, they have these skill sets that almost like nullifies each other. I'm leaning towards Weidman here. Tough one to call. I'm going Weidman by decision. I think he can touch Rockhold a bit. Like I said, like Rockhold's going to be the taller fighter, but not by that much. So that's going to be really interesting. I can see Weidman, you know, just pressing forward and, you know, pushing forward just a little more than Rockhold. So, interesting fight, man. But, yeah, Chris Weidman by decision. Wouldn't be surprised. I don't look at odds. Wouldn't be surprised if the odds are pretty much, like, even or close to even for that matchup. I think they should be. Next fight, that Yoel Romero fights Renato Jacques Souza. Yoel Romero, 10-1 record, 9 wins by KO TKO, 1 win by decision. 38 years old on a 6-fight win streak. He is an Olympic level wrestler. Strong offensive takedown ability. He doesn't do much if he's on top, though. I mean, save for those elbows, he unleashed on Machida that knocked him out. Excuse me there. I guess he does have some pretty good ground and pound. His takedown defense has improved too. You can watch a Tim Kennedy fight, especially. You can see that he defends takedowns really well. It seemed like earlier against when he fought like Honey Marks and like Tim Kennedy that he just wasn't even trying to defend takedowns or didn't even practice takedown defense. So when he was put on his back, he actually doesn't look very good off his back though. But with Romero, he has some strong boxing, heavy hands. This is really long left hand. I think he's southpaw. This is really long cross. Like, it seems really deceptive to his opponents. Like, he always catches his opponent at the end of his cross. And it doesn't seem like it should be able to reach, but it does. And he has this weird way of changing tempo, too, where he'll go quick, then slow, then he'll, like, explode, and then go slow. Jacare Souza, 22-3 record with 1 no contest, 2 wins by KO TKO, 16 wins by decision. That says 2 losses by KO TKO, 35 years old, on an 8-fight win streak, training out of X Gym. He is a former Strikeforce middleweight champion and a top Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu practitioner. Stand-up is greatly improving, especially his boxing, and he's showing to be heavy-handed. When he's on the ground, especially on top, he's a strong guard passer. And his offensive takedown ability is pretty solid. You know, I would rank it up there with just pretty much most wrestlers, really. With that said, though, you know, great fight. Both these guys are elite, but I got to go with Yoel Romero to win this one. I think that he's just – I think he's going to be the better boxer, first of all. I think that he can touch Jacare a good amount of times, and he has power to really put opponents down too. Jacare, I mean, he has some power in his strikes, but you know, I think Romero is going to be just a little better in the boxing department. I see Jacare having a hard time taking Romero down too, so I'm going to go Yoel Romero by KO or TKO. Next fight after that, Demian Maia fights Gunnar Nelson. Demian Maia, 21-6 record, 3 wins by KO TKO, 10 wins by sub, 38 years old, on a 3-fight win streak. He is a top Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu practitioner with strong clinch takedown ability. I mean, this is a guy that takes other wrestlers down. You know, John Fitch, Ryan LaFleur, Rick Story. Magny's not a wrestler, but he took him down and choked him out. You know, he has a really strong top control, strong guard passing, strong back control. His boxing, though, is average, and his cardio is a bit questionable at this point. His ability to take a shot, too, is still a bit questionable, too. Gunnar Nelson, 14-1 record with 1 draw, 3 wins by KO TKO, 10 wins by sub. Same stat there, actually. The finish rate is the same stat. 27 years old, training out of Montenegro, which is like his home gym, and SBG Ireland. He is a top Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu practitioner himself And he also has strong top control, strong guard passing, strong scrambling. Should say that for Maia too. And strong back control. I will say this with Gunnar Nelson. I think Nelson seems a bit more attuned to hunting for the submission than Demian Maia is, who seems more, I mean, save for the Neil Magny fight, Demian Maia seems more control-oriented, whereas Gunnar Nelson, once he establishes control, I mean, he'll really go for the sub, you know, especially if he takes it back. Gunnar Nelson has a karate-style stand-up. One of his problems, though, is that he is a very low-volume striker, and that really cost him against Rick Story. His wrestling, though, is good. One other thing that's really notable about Gunnar Nelson is when he fought Brandon Thatch, he dropped Brandon Thatch. Makes me wonder about Nelson's power these days, if he's sitting down on his punches more and whatnot.
Excuse me.
With that said, tough one for me to call. Nelson's small for the weight class. Maia has cut from middleweight to welterweight. I think at the very least that should help Maia being able to get the takedowns if he chooses to go for them. So with that said, I'm going to go with Demian Maia to win this one by decision. I have a feeling he's going to try and go for takedowns. You know, Gunnar Nelson's really good on the ground, but it's not like he's not, like, Maia, just from what I've seen, I mean, his boxing's okay, and he will box with his opponent, but from what I've seen from Maia, he seems like a guy that's willing against high-level grapplers, too. I mean, even against Donghyun Kim, I mean, he's trying to take him down, too. I get the impression that Maia is, his goal in the cage these days is really to take his opponent down, you know? If he chooses to just box, that evens it out, and I'd actually give Nelson the advantage there, but I'll go Demian Maia by decision. Next fight of that, Max Blessed Holloway fights Jeremy Lil Heathen Stevens. Stevens, 24-11 record, 16 wins by KO TKO, 3 wins by sub. He also has 3 losses by submission. 29 years old, he's a shorter fighter at 5'9", training out of Alliance. His stand-up's good, and he's actually been really improving his stand-up under Alliance. He's becoming less of a brawler, unless he really needs to. Sometimes he'll get into firefight against, like, Bermudez, for example. But he's really heavy-handed, too, both punches and kicks. This guy has knocked guys out with head kicks and with his hands. His overall grappling is improving. He does go for offensive takedowns. His takedown defense looked good against Elkins, looked terrible against Charles Oliveira. And his chin still holding up. Holloway, 14-3 record, 6 wins by KO TKO, 2 wins by sub, 23 years old. He's going to be the taller fighter at 5'11 on a 7-fight win streak, training out of Gracie Technics at Hawaii Elite with the likes of Louis Smolka, Russell Doan. I think Yancy Medeiros trains out of there as well. Holloway is a strong kickboxer. He will use spinning strikes. He uses a spinning back kick to the body, and he is a good body puncher as well. He uses combinations. His takedown defense is really good. His grappling is improving. He's showing a really good front choke series these days. And his chin is really good. And his cardio is strong, too. Like what you see on a Max Holloway in the first round, it's pretty much what you're going to see in the third round. And he'll throw combinations, probably even better in the third round, with his opponent tired and just taking hits than in the first round. So with that said, I can see Holloway picking Jeremy Stevens apart, especially at range. Similar to how Donald Cerrone fought Stevens, is kind of actually how I can see Holloway fight Stevens. So yeah, I'm going to go with Max Holloway to win this by KO or TKO. I think he can pick him apart and get the finish in like the third round. Okay, on the Fox Sports 1 prelims, Urijah, the California kid Faber, fights Frankie Sines. Frankie Sines, 11-2 record, 3 wins by KO TKO, 2 wins by sub, 35 years old on a 7-fight win streak. One thing about him is he is a pressure fighter himself. He's always constantly moving forward, but not necessarily to strike, but to wrestle. You know, he's a strong wrestler with really good top control. His stand-up is kind of average. He does have that good win over Yuri Alcantara. And most recently, he beat, Sean Kawhi, I think, or Kikai. I forgot his last name. Urijah Faber, 32-8 record, 7 wins by KO TKO, 19 wins by sub. He has 3 losses by KO TKO, 39 years old, training out of Team Apple Mail. He is a former WEC featherweight champion. He's a strong wrestler himself with really good ground and pound, strong top control. He's strong in the scrambles, has really strong guillotine. His back control is really good. His stand-up's good. It's not great, and his cardio is really good too. The guys who tend to beat Urijah Faber are guys that can keep him at range. You know, Henan Burrell, Jose Aldo, Frankie Edgar. But Frankie Edgar also went for his own offensive takedowns too. And even like Francisco Rivera for like that the short amount of time that he was, you know, he was finding Faber before the eye poke. I mean, even he was just keeping Faber at range. Frankie Saenz has not shown that skill set. I mean, he's just hasn't shown to be much of a range striker. He's a guy that goes in there, fights a bit ugly, good wrestler, you know, always pushes forward. Against a guy like Faber, though, I think that's going to work against him. So I'm going to go with Urijah Faber to win this one. He has this also uncanny ability to, like, take the back and has that really awesome guillotine. So I'm going to give a favor to get the sub here. I can see Faber possibly getting his own offensive takedowns on signs. And the stand-up, I'd say they're about equal. Faber's getting older. That's the only like thing here. But like Frankie Saenz is 35 himself. He just has a lot less fights. 11-2 versus 32-8. So they're talking about 13 fights versus 40 fights. But I don't think with Faber, it's like he's getting like beaten, but by like the top guys, you know, and I don't think he's at that level yet where he's going to start losing to anything more than like the top five. And I don't think Frankie Saenz is there. So Urijah Faber by submission. Next fight off that, Tecia, the tiny tornado Torres fights Jocelyn lights out Jones-Lybarger. Jones-Lybarger, 6-1 record, 1 win by sub, 5 wins by decision, 30 years old. He's going to be a much taller fighter at 5'7". She is on a 4-fight win streak. A win streak is actually all in RFA, if I'm not mistaken. Trains out of MMA lab with the likes of Benton Henderson. Will be her first fight in the UFC, and she is taking the fight on short notice. She is the RFA strawweight champion. And her boxing has been greatly improving. She uses combinations well. Shows a bit of power, too, you know. Managed to really tag Zala Gurgel in her last fight. And overall grappling is good, too. Tecia Torres, 6-0 undefeated record with all 6 wins by decision. 26 years old. She's 5'1", training out of ATT. She has this, like, taekwondo karate-style stand-up where she, like, She's mainly countered then blitzes her opponent. She does a lot of blitzing too. Her takedown defense is solid, and she actually showed some offensive takedown ability when she went up against Angela Hill in her last fight. Here's, you know, the thing with Lybarger or Jones-Lybarger is she was something of just like this, like wall install grinder for like a really long period of time. And now she's just more of a solid fighter. You know, she seems to have really put everything together. However, she's going against Tecia Torres. She's just really tricky. You know, someone that's relatively hard to hit clean, who blitzes her opponents. You know, she'll also throw like, you know, head kick, you know, different type of kicks and gives her opponents a lot of different looks. And Tecia Torres' takedown defense is pretty good too. So, with that said, I am going to go with Tecia Torres to win this by decision. Biggest problem with Tecia Torres right now, she's just not a finisher. I mean, she's not particularly dangerous, per se. In all the fights I've seen her in, I don't even know. She hits her opponent clean a good amount of times. I've seen her head kick opponents, and they still stand. So that's the biggest problem with Tecia Torres, is she's not particularly, like, she's not a potent finisher. I've never even seen her really drop an opponent. I don't think that'll matter too much in this fight. I'm still going to go Tecia Torres by decision. Next fight, I thought Warlley Alves fights Colby Covington. Covington, 8-0 undefeated record, 5 wins by submission, 3 wins by decision, 27 years old, training out of ATT. He is a strong wrestler. I mean, he has all those, like, accolades that you want with wrestling. His top control is good. His ground and pound is solid. His stand-up is still a work in progress, though. And I'd say it's just average at best right now. Warlley Alves, 9-0, undefeated record, 1 win by TKO, 5 wins by sub, 24 years old, training out of X-Gym. He is an Ultimate Fighter winner with strong Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu skills. His stand-up's good, too. His takedown defense has shown to be pretty good as well. Tough one to call, man. Both of these, I'm going to use blue chip prospect for both of these guys. I think they're very good prospects. My problem is the only avenue I see Colby Covington to win this is wrestling and top control. Whereas with Warlley Alves, I see a little more diversity in the stand-up, and he can get the sub as well. I also think that Covington's probably going to have a hard time taking down Alves and keeping him down. So with that said, I am going to go with Warlley Alves, probably by decision, just because I've never seen Colby Covington, like, really finished. So I'll go Warlley Alves by decision to win this one. But tough to say, man. Real tough to say. Next fight, I thought Kevin Lee fights Leonardo Santos. Kevin Lee, 11-1 record, 5 wins by sub, 6 wins by decision, 23 years old, on a 4-fight win streak, training out of Extreme Couture. I believe the head trainer at Extreme Couture is what, Robert Fallis or Ryan? Is it Robert or Ryan Fallis? No, it's Fallis, who's actually, you know, Extreme Couture actually seems to be coming back. Kevin Lee, strong wrestler, good takedown defense, his ground and pound is good, and stand-up, his boxing is greatly improving as well. Leonardo Santos, 14-3 record with 1 draw, 1 win by KO, 9 wins by sub, he's 35 years old on a 2-fight win streak, training out of Nobu now. He is an Ultimate Fighter Brazil winner, a legit Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belt, with good offensive takedown ability, good top control, stand-up though, average at best. You know, Kevin Lee has already beat, you know, there's, in lightweight, there's these hulking Brazilian top control grinders. Leonardo Santos is one of them, Gleison Tibau, Masranduba, Prazeres, Leandro Silva, they're all like that type of fighter, you know? It's not like they can't stand with their opponent or anything, but like their strength really is like getting on top, staying on top, you know, and whatnot, and just being, like, huge for the weight class, too. Generally huge for the weight class. I mean, Leonardo Santos used to fight at welterweight and has even had trouble making weight at 155, has had bad weight cuts from 155 at times. But Kevin Lee, he's beaten Frazeres, so he's only beaten one of these, like, hulking Brazilian top control grinders. I think he can do it again. I think he has the better stand-up. I think he can avoid getting taken down. He's going to have to put his working boots on because, you know, Leonardo Santos, he's tough. You know, he's tough to put away. He's big, you know. But, yeah, I'm going to go with Kevin Lee to win this one. Probably be by decision. I'll probably go by decision there. Okay, on to Fight Pass prelims. Magomed Mustafaev fights Joe Proctor. Mustafaev, 12-2 record, 8 wins by KO TKO, 4 wins by sub, 27 years old, on a 10-fight win streak. Training out of Fight Club Bakut. There's other, like, Dagestani Russian fighters. I want to say Dagestani fighters that train out of Fight Club Bakut. And I want to say that Ioana Jacek trains there as well, if I'm not mistaken. And also trains at ATT as well. Mustafaev does have a sambo base. His stand-up's just kind of average at this point, though. But he always has that sambo base to take opponents down if need be. Joe Proctor, 11-3 record, 2 wins by KO Tigo, 5 wins by sub, 30 years old. Everything about him is a bit average, you know, like his stand-up's good, it's not great, his grappling is good, it's not, you know, I wouldn't say it's that great, you know, like he's good everywhere, but not great at any one aspect of MMA. So with that said, a guy with the Sambo credentials of Weidman Mustafaev, I got to pick him to win this one. He is a finisher too. So, I'm going to go Magomed Mustafa by K or TKO. Maybe I can ground a pound finish or something like that. I can see him taking down Joe Proctor. I can see him beating them up too. So, yeah, Magomed Mustafa by KO or TKO. Next fight off that, John the Bull McDessie fights Yancy Medeiros. McDessie, 13-4 record, 9 wins by K or TKO, 4 wins by decision, 30 years old. It's going to be the shorter fighter at 5'8", training out of TriStar. He does have a Taekwondo base, but he actually has shown really good boxing, a particularly good jab. He has a strong chin. Now, when he fought Cerrone, the thing that actually put him away was that he broke his jaw, but he didn't actually drop him. Did he drop him? I remember he just kind of writhed in pain from, like, his broken jaw. He's got a really good chin. Yancy Medeiros, 11-3 record with 1-0 contest, 6 wins by KO Tico, 3 wins by sub. That's his 2 losses by KO Tico. 28 years old. He's going to be the taller fighter at 5'10". I like his stand-up. He's actually pretty heavy-handed. His grappling's pretty good. His takedown defense isn't too bad. He actually has shown to have some pretty good front chokes himself. I got to go with Yancy Medeiros in this one. I think he's just a taller, rangier guy. I can see him keeping McDessie at range. Both of these guys like to scrap. With that said, but McDessie has a really good chin. So I'm going to Yancy Medeiros in this one by decision. And finally, Marcio Lyoto Alexander Jr. fights Court McGee. Alexander Jr., 11-2 record, 10 wins by KO Tico, 1 win by sub, 26 years old, on a 2-fight losing streak. Training out of Team Tavares and Blackhouse, he has a karate-style stand-up, and his grappling is just pretty average. Court McGee, 16-4 record, 3 wins by KO Tico, 7 wins by sub, 30 years old, training out of Pit Elevated. He's an Ultimate Fighter winner. However, the last time he fought is December of 2013. He's a good wrestler. Stand-up's average, but he's always pushing forward. Super resilient, tough to put away. And his Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu skills are solid as well. If lightweight has the hulking Brazilians, welterweight has these blue-collar fighters. They have like Mike Pierce, Ryan LaFleur, George Sullivan, Court McGee, there's a couple others too that are just like these total like bring your lunch pail type fighters. There's another one too whose name absolutely escapes me. Kenny Robertson. He's another just like these super tough, you know, tough to put away, well-rounded enough. Usually they're all wrestlers too, you know, well-rounded enough. Guys that are tough to put away, always pushing forward, high work rate type guys. Court McGee's just one of those guys. And I can see just Court McGee outworking Marcio Alexander, taking him down, clinching with him if need be. And I'm going to go Court McGee to win this one by submission. So to recap, the main card of Jose Aldo beating Conor McGregor by decision. Chris Weidman versus Luke Rockhold of Chris Weidman by decision. Yoel Romero versus Ronaldo Jacare Souza. I have Yoel Romero by KO or TKO. Damian Maia versus Gunnar Nelson. I have Damian Maia by decision. Max Holloway versus Jeremy Stevens. I have Max Holloway by KO or TKO. On to prelims. Urijah Faber fights Frankie Sines. I have Urijah Faber by submission. Tecia Torres fights Jocelyn Jones-Lybarger. Tecia Torres by decision. Warlley Alves fights Colby Covington. Warlley Alves by decision. Kevin Lee fights Leonardo Santos. Kevin Lee by decision. On the UFC Fight Pass prelims, Magomed Mustafaev fights Joe Proctor. Magomed Mustafaev by KO or TKO. John McDessie fights Yancy Medeiros. Yancy Medeiros by decision. Marshall Alexander Jr. fights Court McGee. I have Court McGee by submission. So that's it for my predictions for UFC 194, Aldo versus McGregor. If you have any comments, just leave them below. And also don't forget to participate in the MMA For You Predictions Contest. Send in your predictions for UFC Fight Night 80, UFC 194, The Ultimate Fighter 22 Finale, and UFC and Fox 17 to the CND channel at gmail.com. This coming Saturday is actually UFC Fight Night 80, so make sure to send in your picks, at least for that card, before Saturday, before the event happens. So that's it for MMA For You. Thank you guys very much.